Well, hallelujah. This is the class on the Holy Spirit. This is lesson number 7. And we want to go to, believe it or not, John chapter 16. I'm believing you're going to get familiar with John 14, 15, 16, and 17. But I hope you notice that most of these chapters are full of red letters, which means it must be Jesus talking. And how many of you know if he talks, we ought to listen? John chapter 16, let's look at a couple of verses here. And like I say, we finished up with verse 11. Let's just start with verse 12, John chapter 16. Jesus says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit. Now, this is not exactly a part of the lesson, but, you know, it's too important a point to pass over. What was he saying when he said, you can't handle it now, but howbeit? When the Spirit comes, what's he saying? He's saying that up until this point, you hadn't been able to totally spiritually comprehend what I'm saying to you because you don't have the Spirit of God in you to teach you. Okay, now we need to see this because there's so many people hadn't got the idea yet that from Genesis, and we're still moving in that direction, there's no one been born again or made spiritually alive yet. And so for God to communicate to them, he's going to have to do it through their soul and their body. And that's the reason, once again, folks, you go back in the Old Testament and look what was involved in all of their worship. All the things that had to be done physically and mentally. Why? Because that's the only way he was able to communicate. And then when Jesus came on the scene, he began to tell them. You know, you've read this over here, and you've heard it's been said of them of old, thus, thus, and thus. And he says, but let me give you a little spiritual insight, since you hadn't got that up until this point. But I say unto you, remember all those teachings that Jesus did? And he was taking what they had understood intellectually up to that point and saying, well, you saw it with your intellect, but let me give you a spiritual insight here. And he was preparing them for this time when the Spirit would come into them so that they would listen to that Spirit and say, well, I'm not going to just live by the dead letter of the Word. I mean, you know, that's what Paul said. The letter kills. It's the Spirit that gives life. Are you seeing the connection? I got to get on to the lesson, but I want you to see, he says, you can't understand this yet. I've got a lot of things I want to share with you, but you can't comprehend them. Because if I said them to you at this particular point in time, you just try to do it with your intellect and you come up with the wrong meaning. Hallelujah. You almost think Jesus need to come preach that message again, wouldn't you? Because how many of you know, most of us, the way we've been brought up, we approach God with our intellect. And to this day, even when we're born again, even when we receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, who just blew in like a rushing mighty wind, we still spend much of our time trying to understand God with our head. That's the reason we have all these weird questions. That's why we come up with all these things that really don't have anything to do with eternity. And we dwell on things. It's amazing that the Scripture says we are to set our affection on things above, and yet the majority of a Christian's time spent on things of this world. And even taking scriptural truth and trying to apply it to the things of this world. Hello? And so Jesus said, I could tell you, but you couldn't grasp it yet. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you unto all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, Now let's stop a minute. We need to understand that when we see the word glorify and the word glory, we're talking about recognizing and acknowledging His presence. And right here, let's go on, because I get ahead of myself if I'm not careful. He shall glorify me, for He shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I that He shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. So we can stop right there, and here's the things, and I'll just tell you ahead of time, we're not going to get to cover all these in detail because of time. But see, it won't be a great disservice for me not to tell you. You look it up yourself. But here's the things that you need to remember that He's going to do when He comes. Number one, and we'll go ahead and list these. He'll guide us into all truth. Need to remember that. When the Spirit has come, now we're talking about to the believer. All right, last lesson we were talking about what He was going to do to the people of the world, but now we're talking about what He's going to do in the life of the believer. Okay, are you seeing the transition? Now Jesus is talking to His followers. So now He's saying when the Spirit has come to you the believer, this is what He'll do to you. We talked about last time what He's going to do to the world, but now we're talking about what He's going to do to you. And number one, He's going to guide you into all truth. Hallelujah. He'll guide us in all truth. Now, I need to just add a little statement there. If we'll let Him. He's willing, but in order for it to happen, you have to be willing. How many of you know we are the ones that are in charge of our thinking? And if you refuse to renew your mind, if you refuse to alter your thinking to come in line with the truth that the Holy Spirit will reveal, then you can't grasp that truth. He's willing to guide you into truth, but you have to be willing to go there. And you know what? A lot of you are going to have to put down your preconceived religious ideas. And to some, that might be easy. To others, it's going to be hard because you've held on to them for so long. They've almost become a part of you. He'll guide you in all truth. That's number one. Number two, this is real important. He'll not speak on His own authority. In other words, the Holy Spirit doesn't have His own agenda. The Holy Spirit's not doing His thing. And boy, now this is a message that needs to be ministered in the Spirit-filled New Testament, Pentecostal, full gospel, charismatic, word of faith churches. He'll not speak of His own authority, but whatever He hears from heaven, whatever God says needs to be spoken to us, that's what the Holy Spirit will convey to us. We need to understand that the Holy Spirit is in submission to the Father and the Son. Number three, He'll show us things to come. And the reason He's able to show us things to come is because He's listening to what the Father says, and how many of you know the Father knows the end from the beginning? God doesn't wake up some morning and say, man, I never looked for that to happen. What are we going to do now? See, He knows the end from the beginning. So it's not a problem for God to be able to reveal what's going to come to pass. But you know what? It's going to be in line with what's already been recorded. Hello? How will He show us things to come? He'll give us revelation out of what's already recorded about what's to come. And a lot of people don't like to hear it, but if you'll read the Scripture in just what Scripture says, I want to tell you the world's not going to get any better. And I don't care who gets elected. I mean, you better get your hope set on something besides this world, because this thing is going down the tube in a hurry. Now, the good news for us is this: the darker the world gets, the brighter our light will shine. But Christians, we need to understand that we're in the world, but we're not of it, and we're not controlled by the world system or what goes on in our government. And yet you got millions probably of believers that their only hope is who wins in November. Now, I've got my preferences. I believe you ought to be wise. I believe you ought to seek God. I think you ought to vote righteousness. So is that, everybody hearing what I'm saying? But you know, I don't give up if the one I want doesn't win. Because you know what? Whoever wins, Jesus will still be on the throne. And he'll still do what he wants to do, whether Congress approves of it or not. Hallelujah. I'm not trying to be political here. I'm trying to be get your head in the right place, folks. I'm telling you, you don't see Jesus being a whole lot concerned about the world system when he was here. Now, how many of you know it was worse then than it is now? Hallelujah. Well, moving right along. Number four, he'll glorify Jesus. We'll amplify that if we get to it. But one of the things that the Holy Spirit wants to do in your life is make you more aware of the presence of Jesus in your life. And we need to begin to understand that God's will, Romans chapter 8, verse number 29, says that those he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his son Jesus, that Jesus might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now, don't get carried away religiously on the word foreknowledge and predestination. People got real weird. Let me break it down to you where even, you know, I had to put things on the level I understand. Foreknowledge. Well, we talked about it already. God already knows the end from the beginning. He's not surprised at anything that happens. God already knew before we ever even gave it an idea that we'd be here this morning. Isn't that good? Aren't you glad we serve a God that has that ability? So he knew every single one of us, and he knows every single person that's going to make a commitment to him through Jesus Christ. He knows every single one of them. And for every single person that he knows that's going to be born again, he already has a plan for you before you ever get there. And that ought to be good news, because see, look at all of us that have been born again. Now, wouldn't it be bad if 100 of us got born again in one day and God didn't know that we were going to, and all of a sudden they scramble in heaven and say, we got 100, we got to come up with a plan for these folks. But see, he knew you were coming, he knew when you were going to get here, and he already had a plan for you when you got there. That's what predestined means. He has a plan for us before we get there because he knows we're coming. Now, part of that plan, not all of that plan, but part of that plan, and the major part of that plan, is that every single one of us that came to a knowledge of Jesus are to begin to be just like him. It says, conform to his image, being fashioned like him. And there's a reason he wants that, because Jesus, now let's back up, Jesus is said to be the express image of the Father. To the degree that he says, if you've seen me, you've seen God. All right, if Jesus was in the image of God so that people could see God, and we're to be conformed to the image of Jesus, guess what's supposed to be happening in our lives? We're supposed to be being molded and made and conformed and shaped so that people can see God in us. Hello? That's what it's all about. That's why we're here. And you say, well, why is it that way? Because God chose to have it that way. He trusted us. I told you, he's a faith God. He believes we're going to get it done. He's got confidence in us. And he's always encouraging us and telling us, wake up, church. The work I started in you, I'm going to complete.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Mm. And the good news about the Lord, right there in the same chapter of Romans chapter 8, it says, for we know this, that all things will work together for good. That's not the end of the verse. To those who love God and are called according to his purpose. I tell you what a freedom came into my life when God gave me a revelation on that verse, because, see, I qualify because, number one, I love God. And I know he loves me. Number two, I know I'm called. So even if I make a mistake in my walking out my calling, because I love him and I am called, he'll make it work. Man, I'm telling you, what a deal. They used to have a TV commercial. You just can't lose with the stuff I use. Well, I want you to know you can't lose with God if you'll just stay hooked up to him and quit trying to figure it all out with your peanut brain.
Amen.
That's where faith comes in. Hello?
Yes.
See, if you knew everything, you wouldn't need any faith. But we want everything planned out, step by step. And you even, I can't go there. I'd sound too critical. No. No. But we are to walk by faith and not by sight. And I want you to know you don't have to have every step planned out for the next 20 years. I tell you how far ahead I've planned. I got to get to the airport this afternoon. And I planned far enough ahead to tell my wife what time I'm supposed to get there, where she picked me up. After that, I just may take us out to eat one of those good steaks. I hear that ribeye calling. Come and eat. That's scriptural. Come and dine, the master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude and turned the water into wine, to the hungry calling now, come and dine. Now, what class is this? Oh, I still got another one after this. I'm a class early. Man, I was about ready to break and run. Hallelujah. Number five. He'll receive from Jesus and show it to us. Now, those are the things you need to remember. He'll guide you into all truth. He'll not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears from heaven, he'll speak. He'll show us things to come. He'll glorify Jesus, and he'll receive from Jesus and show it to us. Now, for the sake of time, I want to give you an example of how you break those points down. Number one, and this is what we've got time for, we'll take number one there just as an illustration, but in your own time, you need to do this on all of these points. But number one, it says he'll guide us into all truth. He'll guide us into all truth. The Holy Spirit, if we will let him, will guide us into areas of truth from the Word of God that will totally transform our lives. And see, this is... We know that when we were born again, our spirit man became brand new and made in the image and likeness of God. But Paul says to us in Romans chapter 12, he says, but there's a couple of other parts that need some work. And he says, so I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and totally acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. In other words, we got to realize that our body has now become that temple. Our body has now become the dwelling place of God on planet Earth. You know, you can go to the Old Testament and the Bible says that God instructed Moses how to build a tabernacle, but it was based upon the heavenly pattern. In other words, the real thing. And it's amazing that as you get into that study, you'll find out that the tabernacle consisted of the outer court, the inner court, and the Holy of Holies. And what it shows you is that outer court's our body. And then we move into the soul, and then that most holy place where the Spirit of God lived and dwelt is our spirit man. So even in the tabernacle, you have the Trinity of man being taught. And so we know that when we're born again, because of the fact that we couldn't do anything about that one, so God totally did a miraculous work and caused us to be made a brand new creature in Christ on the inside, our spirit. But now because we have that ability in us, then the soul and the body are put under our authority to deal with, to bring into submission. And he says, so present your body as a living sacrifice. In other words, he doesn't want you to get up on the altar and burn your body up. It's a living sacrifice. It's supposed to stay totally, but notice it's always supposed to be totally committed to him. And then in verse 2 it says, and do not be conformed, or do not let this world fashion you. Don't let the world shape you. Don't let the world give you your value system. Don't let the world dictate to you how you're to live life. But be transformed, or totally, completely changed. And the process is through renewing your mind. Which means, believe it or not, it involves a process of getting rid of the old and replacing it with that which is new. Now, how many of you know that it doesn't make any difference how old you were when you were born again? You already had some stuff put in your head that were contrary to the things of God. Here's one of the first things that was planted in your head. Take care of number one. And most of us, we didn't see anything wrong with that, and we kind of saw the value of that because, you know, it's kind of a dog-eat-dog world, and if you don't take care of yourself, who's going to take care of you? Isn't that kind of the process we were all brought up in? And you know what? It's infiltrated the church. I mean, you know, most people go to church based upon what it'll do for them. And if you don't sing what I want you to sing, if you don't preach what I want you to preach, if you don't have the programs I want you to have, then I'm out of here. See, we've let the world dictate to us that we have a choice. And it even comes on Christian radio. Go to the church of your choice this Sunday. Doesn't that sound good? Doesn't that appeal to the carnal mind? But you know what God says? Go to the church of my choice. Where do I want you? And why are you going? Not to be served, but to be served. Because Jesus said, here's the way it works in my kingdom. If you want to be great in this one, you got to learn to be the servant of them all. I mean, you know, that goes totally contrary to the world system. Are you seeing what I'm talking about? And so every single one of us, regardless of what age we were when we came to a saving knowledge of Jesus, we had some stuff already in our head which was based upon the world system of teaching, and we've got to get those thoughts out and begin to operate in his thoughts. The Bible says in Colossians that we have been translated, this is something that God did, out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son, or into the kingdom of light. Does it say that? And I mean, you know, it doesn't mean at some time in the future. It means the minute that you're born again and become a new creature, you become a citizen of a new kingdom. Now, where the church is having difficulty is we're in a new kingdom, but we're still trying to operate by old kingdom principles. And it was never made clearer to me than when we moved to England back in 97, I think it was. I never lived anywhere except Texas and Colorado. I had an adjustment when I moved from Texas to Colorado. Those of you that moved from other states to Colorado, how many of you had some adjustment to do? And one of the first things that that slapped me upside the head when we moved up here was the cost of living. It's cheaper to live in Texas. We got better steaks in Texas. Got better restaurants in Texas. Y'all are looking at me like you don't believe it. Well, I speak with authority. I have checked them out myself and am here to report. They're awesome. But I had a shock, but you know what? I had to adapt to living in Colorado and paying higher prices for everything. I mean, the first time I went grocery shopping in Colorado, it took me a while to... And the way people think and the way people dress and the way they act and the air you breathe. I don't know about that. There's not much of it up here. I try not to read bumper stickers. I don't want to sin. Bumper stickers will get you in trouble. Honk if you love Jesus. Honk, honk. You're sorry. Anyhow, moving right along, there was an adjustment to live in Colorado. And I thought, and see, God's so gracious. He moved me from Texas to Colorado, made that adjustment. Then I moved from Colorado to England. Oh, you talk about a shock to the system. Get off the plane. It's time to have coffee. Go down to the coffee shop in the airport. Pull out my nice green American dollars. I want a cup of coffee. Sorry, sir. What do you mean, sorry? Don't you have any coffee? Yeah, we got coffee. I said, well, why can't I have some coffee? He said, well, you don't have any money. I said, there is good old US of A American dollars. How many you want for a cup of coffee? Oh, you don't understand, sir. We don't take dollars. Now, I've got to make a decision. Because I'm not living in the good old US of A anymore. And the UK will not accept your dollar. You can stand there and argue. You can tell them it's as good as theirs. It looks better than theirs. It's more impressive than theirs. You can go through all of this stuff and they'll still tell you, we're not taking it. If you're going to buy coffee in here, you're going to have to get you some English pounds. English currency. So down you go to Thomas C. Cook, and you give them all of your American dollars, and you get back just a few, very few English pounds. Very few. Very, very, very few. So now, what's happening? I'm making a transition from one kingdom to another. And right off of the plane, I find out that my good American money won't work. So what am I going to do if I'm going to stay there? I'm going to have to get with the program, and I'm going to have to get English money. Are you listening to me? All right. Then I need a car. So I'll go down to rent a car. And they show me a car, and I said, don't want that car. Why don't you want that car? I said, the steering wheel's on the wrong side. I'm going to drive, not my passenger. I'm going to drive. I want one with it. Now, you know, I could have still been there in that rental car place arguing. They will not move the steering wheel. So what have I got to do? I'm in a different kingdom now. Are you listening to me? I'm not in the kingdom of the United States anymore. I'm in the kingdom of England, the United Kingdom. Now, if I'm going to drive a car, I got to drive it with the steering wheel on the wrong side. And then you pull out to the highway. You got to get on the wrong side of the road. Now, I could have said, I'm not going to drive on that side. You made me drive with the steering wheel on the wrong side, but I refused to drive on the wrong side of the road. And you know what? I probably would have lasted about 2 miles on the motorway. And one of their big lorries, which is their term for 18-wheeler, would have smashed me flat. So what did I have to do? I had to adjust. Why? I'm in a different kingdom. Are you getting the point? I changed where I lived to a new place I live, and they don't operate the same way. And then it just got worse. I was so hungry for Mexican food. There's not a lot of them. But there was a mall, and I can't remember where it had just opened and had a food court, and somebody said, they've got Mexican food at the food. We're going to the mall. On the wrong side of the road, on the wrong side of the car, using the wrong kind of money, but I'm going for the Mexican food. So I get there, and I'm looking, and it smells good. Looks good. Looks like the real stuff. And so I go up to the young lady in this little food kiosk, and my wife said, what are you going to start with? I said, well, we hadn't had it since we've been here. I'm going to start off with chips and salsa. So I said to the lady, I'd like some chips and salsa. She looked at me and said, pardon? I thought on that one for a while, and I said, must be my Texas accent. I would like some chips and salsa. Pardon? I said, you know, chips and salsa. She says, well, sir, if you want chips, you'll have to go over to the chip shop. I said, no, no, no. These things right here, what are those? She said, oh, those are corn crisps. Now, you've got some students here that can verify I'm not telling the untruth. And in order to have what I wanted, I had to order corn crisp and salsa. Chips are what you get with fish. They're French fries here, but the English don't like the French. Wonder if we got a school in France. God loves the French. What was I doing? I'm adapting because I've changed kingdoms. Are you listening to me? We're having a little fun, but I'm trying to drive a point home to you. And then I found out I didn't even know how to use a fork. See, we use a fork with the tines, you know, isn't that what you call them, tines? Yeah. We use them with the tines turned up. Over there, you use them turned down. So I'm trying to be proper, and the first few times, stab myself right there. And when you're eating in England, you never put down your fork and knife. Huh. You just start, and you watch some of those people. And I used to say, you folks eat like vacuum cleaners. Then I found out that's not proper. They eat like a Hoover. I mean, I'd still be cutting my food up, and they're through. Because you don't ever put them down. Once you start, you never put it down. And you know, over here where we'd cut our steak and then put our knife down and then change hands with the forks and no, 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 no. It's a real treat. Any of you going to the UK on your mission trip?
Not anymore.
I'd encourage you to go because you know what? After you go and spend a little while, you'll come back over here and you'll never say another bad word about gas being $2 a gallon. Because when we were there in June, it was almost 8. Yeah, oh. And you only get 1 pound for every one of your $2. Hallelujah. But, you know, God's God in England, too. He still works miracles over there. The point, and I've got to wind this up, but do you see what I'm talking about? When we were born again, we changed kingdoms. We went from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, and there's different principles and systems and rules and regulations in this new kingdom. And if you don't renew your mind and begin to cooperate with the new kingdom rules, you're going to stay frustrated. And one of those, just real obvious, in the kingdom you came out of, the theory is to get all you can all you get. But in the kingdom of God, it says that if you want to receive, you're going to have to learn to give. Are you listening to me? You know, in the old kingdom you were in, you wanted everybody to bless you and give to you. I mean, we were just all caught up in us. We moved into the new kingdom. The new kingdom principle is it's better to give than it is to receive. I mean, you know the church hadn't got that revelation yet. What am I talking about? I'm talking about renewing your mind to the Word of God. Don't be conformed. Now, how do we learn these things of the new kingdom? Well, that's what the Holy Spirit's given to us to do. To guide us into all truth. And He'll guide you into all truth concerning redemption. I'm talking about get in there and begin to read about redemption. Read the book of Hebrews if you want to get a clear picture. It's an eternal redemption. It won for just part of the time, for part of the people. And every once in a while, Jesus has to run back and update it. Listen, it was once and for all. And redemption, the word redemption, not only means a price was paid, but the power to produce what the price paid for is involved in it. So He didn't just pay the price for our salvation, but came with the price, the power to produce it. And if you go to the book of Exodus, you begin to see that total picture of redemption. Not only did He make provision for the people to be redeemed, but He had the provision for them to go right into the kingdom that He had planned for them. It's called the land of promise in the Old Testament. And God, when He first dealt with them, said, come out of there and come into the land that I provided for you. That was redemption. Because the price paid to get you out was enough. It was also accompanied by the power to get you in. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that when you got born again, God didn't say, well, you're on your own from now on. But see, a lot of people hadn't understood that redemption is God's plan to take us from where we were to where we're supposed to be. The price has been paid, and a lot of the church understands the price that's been paid, but they haven't understood that with the price came the power to get you there. See, it's one thing to get you out. I mean, you know, it's a totally different thing to get you in. And the book of Exodus paints you the picture that He got them out, but they struggled with His plan to get them in. I mean, you know, that's what's happening in the church today. We've kind of grasped the fact that the price was paid through His blood. I mean, you weren't bought with silver and gold. You were bought with the blood of Jesus. So we understand that purchase, but we haven't understood that along with the purchase came the power to bring you to where He wants you to be. He brought you out in order to bring you in. And redemption is the whole package. Hallelujah. And see, that's where a lot of other mistakes come in. You know, people reading the Old Testament, they think that God had these people that weren't going to be accepted unless they kept the law. This is always a good subject, the law versus grace. Now, I don't know who came up with that term. It's not in the Bible. I mean, you know, the people that received the law were the people already redeemed. How were they redeemed? Same way we are, the blood of the Lamb. Go back and read it. It was the blood of the Lamb. In the Old Testament, it was a woolly little four-legged creature called the Passover Lamb. But it was through them accepting what God said was needed, the application of the blood, and they were a redeemed people. And to this redeemed people that He was taking on a journey, He gave the law. Why did He do that? Because He said, here's the way you need to live life, and live it abundantly, And the way you do it is to do it the way I teach you, not the way you've been learning it down in Egypt. Now let's bring that into the church. I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Nothing added to that. But then I've got the whole Word of God that tells me how I are to live life in order to receive all that God has for me. And He's not going to use the world system to get it to you. And I'm talking about every area of life. Now let's just stop and analyze. How many of you know that the majority of Christians are concerned about the same things that the majority of the world is concerned about? What does that say to the world? We don't have anything going for us. They don't have going for them. I heard an atheist one time challenge a supposedly Christian minister. And he says, tell me something in your life that you have that you can only attribute to God that I don't have in my life, and I don't even believe there is a God. It's kind of a sobering question. Sometimes we need to inventory ourselves and see what is it that we have in our life that would testify to other people that there is a living God. So, you know, we're living in a day that a lot of emphasis is put on financial prosperity. I don't have anything against financial prosperity. Matter of fact, I believe the Scripture teaches that we're to prosper. But let me tell you, there's probably more wealthy people in the world who aren't Christians than there are that are Christians. So, you know, my message of financial prosperity as being an example of God blessing me won't hold water. I'm just throwing this out for your thought. I'm not trying to get you to come to any conclusion. But see, we've got to zero in and say, what is it that we're going to be able to receive from the Lord as the Holy Spirit begins to reveal it to us and incorporate it into our daily living, that people will look at us and see that God is really alive in our lives. See, that ought to challenge us. What can you attribute to God that only God can do in your life? Well, you know, one of the things is when we as believers get beyond the point of worrying. The Bible says, take no thought for tomorrow. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything. Well, man, I see Christians walking around right now because it's election time. We got Christians that are about to panic because they're afraid their man won't win. I rest my case. The Holy Spirit will guide you into truth concerning your redemption. He'll guide you into truth if you'll let Him, concerning the new birth. Because once again, as I've said time and time again in these classes, the majority of people who profess to be Christians don't even know what happened to them. You say, how do you know that? Because I was born again for I don't know how many years before I had a revelation of what happened. Did I experience it? Absolutely, because all it takes is faith to believe that what God said is true and accept that, and it'll happen. But I'm telling you, we ought to pursue that and let the Holy Spirit show us what really took place in our lives when we were born again. And if you find out that you had a birth, as you were birthed into this world in the flesh, you were birthed into God's world in the spirit, and they're the same kind of experience. You were one minute not, and the next minute you are. And the Holy Spirit will show you truth concerning the new birth. And then the last one, and we don't have time to amplify on this, but you can work. He'll begin to reveal the truth about our authority. Do you realize that most of the church is squalling and bawling and complaining to God, why, God, aren't you doing something about this? And if we had ears to hear, God saying, the ball's in your court. I gave you the authority. Let me give you a real quick biblical example. Read, I think it's Exodus 14, where they're about to cross the Red Sea. Remember, God's delivered them out of Egypt. They're on their journey. They come to the sea. It looks uncrossable. Pharaoh's army's behind them. Moses is out in front of the people saying, be calm, be cool, everything's under control. Then he runs behind the rock and said, oh God, what are we going to do? It's in there. That was the paraphrase edition. And when he began to ask, God began to ask him, what you got in your hand, Moses? What's he saying? I've given you the authority. You're supposed to be leading these people. What are you going to do? Read it. It's in there. And you know what God says? Well, Moses, it's up to you. How are you going to get across the Red Sea? Tough question. So, God is gentle. I give you a hint, Moses. Check what you got in your hand. What you got? Ah, it's a rod. He said, won't you see what happens if you stretch that rod out? Now, how many of you know they'd still been waiting by the sea if Moses hadn't have got up there and stuck out his rod? How many of you know it took his action. It took him doing what God had told him to do in order for God to be able to do it. Now, see, I know Moses didn't by his own ability. Party, but how many of you know he had to act with the authority that God had given him? Read it over there. Just go right on through Scripture. You get over to Jericho. God says to Joshua, see, I've given you the city. Read it. And you know what's going through Joshua's mind? They're in there. We're out here, but it's ours. Isn't that right? And then God says, well, here's what it's going to take, Joshua. You've got the authority to do something. Give me a hint. He said, march around. You know, Joshua said, oh, yeah, this is the way everybody takes cities, just to walk around it, you know. And so God says, well, I'm going to give you another hint. You better tell everybody that's marching with you, just keep their mouth shut. Because if you get to talking, you're going to talk yourself right into unbelief. So just shut up and do what you're told. Now, God probably says it's a little nicer than that, but I'm not God, so. So how many of you know, in order for that the walls to fall down, they had to do what God told them they had the authority to do. Move over into Judges. Here's poor little Gideon hiding behind the rock, because here come the Midianites. They always show up when the harvest comes in. And the angel of the Lord appears and said, hail thou mighty man of valor. Gideon said, who's he talking to? You know what? This is what God's saying to all of us. You mighty men and women of valor. Stand up and do something. What? Well, I gave you the authority. Authority of what? Over everything. It started in Genesis. He created man, said, now, you got authority over everything else that's created. Birds of the air. Fish of the sea. Every creep. Read it, it's in Genesis. Adam and Eve submitted that authority to the devil. Jesus came along years later, took it back, and made the statement. Before he left, he said, all authority, heaven and earth, been given to me. Now, I'm sending you in that authority. Go do it. You've got the authority over what? Everything. But see, we don't even realize we've got authority over the devil. Most of the time, we're begging him not to do something to us. Oh, please, Mr. Devil. Come on, wake up. You know why the world's in the shape it's in? Because of us. We've allowed it to happen. We haven't taken our authority. Because you know why? We want to do it the world's way. Well, let's vote in some righteousness. Let's see if we can get some legislation passed that will promote morality. And we'll take authority over immorality by going to the ballot box. Are you listening to me? Man, when the church realizes what authority they got, we can start putting them little hairy demons on the run and taking back the world and seeing Jesus be exalted. Well, he'll guide you into all truth, and we're out of time, so take a break.
Faith.